Sacrificial love. Sacrificial love and innocence is the topic of this week. Glad to see you made it here today. As always, because we have gathered here in the name of Jesus Christ, glory be to God. He is alive. He lives. I believe it is by the power of his good spirit he has brought us here today. You know, sacrificial love, it's a big topic. And, you know, we've talked about, if you've been with us all week, how sacrificial love is wound up, summed up in forgiveness. Forgiveness is a gift given to somebody. And sometimes in giving that gift, we free ourselves from the bondages of anger and disappointment. I know for my own life and being around other people, you can be swamped in anger. Swamped in anger and feelings of rejection and these things, and maybe you have a righteous sense of anger within you, and maybe these feelings of rejections are real. But don't let it consume you. Don't let it consume you. We went over Samson's story in the last teaching, and if you missed that, please go check it out. We can learn a lot from Samson, and in it, you know, I think what we're going to kind of go over today is a little bit about discernment. Because having a sense of discernment empowers us to be able to give away love without expecting anything in return. It empowers us with that ability. But we have to have that sense of discernment, and the discernment comes from the baptism of the Holy Spirit, and the baptism of the Holy Spirit comes through the washing of the Word, being fully immersed in Jesus Christ. And Jesus Christ is the living Word of God, so we must be fully immersed in His Word. And I think a lot of our struggles and problems all across the world, and especially here in America, come from the fact that somewhere along the line, moms and dads and grandmas and grandpas stopped teaching their children the Bible. The stories of the Bible, stop teaching about Samson, stop teaching about Elijah, stop teaching about David and some of the struggles he had to deal with, Moses and the struggles he had to deal with. And because we abandoned the stories written in there in the Bible, we lost our sense of discernment. And then you place our children, as Jesus says, you know, I'm sending you out as sheep among wolves. So you need a sense of discernment, because like a lamb, you're wandering out there amongst a bunch of ferocious, vicious wolves. And if you don't have the teachings and instructions to set in place boundaries, and you don't have the Holy Spirit upon you to ignite in you a sense of discernment, and you're out there as a lamb amongst the wolves, you might get hurt. And it's not your fault. If you've been sexually molested or abused as a child, it's not your fault. And sometimes, you know, that's the thing, is whatever it was that happened in our lives, We had no control over it. We had no control over it. I'm like a lamb in the midst of a pack of ferocious wolves. And I had no control. I didn't have the strength to do anything about it. And that might be so. And it probably was so. You know, we learn in Samson's story is when he comes in contact with Delilah. She, it's a spirit that controls over a person. And the spirit of Delilah is still running around rapid there in all across the United States of America. It is a, what we've come to know in modern day terms, a narcissistic, malignant spirit. It will destroy you, and unlike the spirit of Jezebel, which purposely seeks out preachers and teachers of the gospel, seeks to destroy church folks, through the works of slander, turning a lie into a weapon to be used to destroy the church, the men and women of God. That's the Jezebel spirit. Now, the spirit of Delilah goes and it looks for each and every angle. And it may not be a preacher, teacher, man or woman of God or of the church, just a regular everyday Joe out there in the world. And they look you over, and just as a good narcissist does, you know, that they want to know all of your secrets and what it is that connects you to God, so they can sever that connection between you and God. And they look for the truth. And then they want to try and turn that truth into a weapon against you. And maybe sometimes we were in a situation in life where the truth might be embarrassing. The truth might be damaging. So they're not looking to twist a lie into some form of a weapon and use it as an act of slander against you to tear down your reputation. They take the time to go in and find the truth and then use that truth as a weapon. And I've met people like this in my life. And because I had a sense of discernment, because I had the teachings and instructions of God and a sense of boundaries, I was able to quickly as I could, eliminate that person from my life. And sometimes we have to do that. Sometimes we have to do that. It's okay to be angry. It's okay to say that not only am I angry at what you did to me, it's okay to say you hurt me. You violated me. You broke me and left me living under the effects of this brokenness, and it was damaging. It's okay to admit those things and speak of those things, but don't let it control over you. Don't let it control over you. Don't allow that to define you. Don't allow the storm, this outward problem or situation that happened to us that was outside of our control, define who we are inside. Don't allow that. And sometimes we have to see the red flags and take it for what it is and then thrust those people away from us as far as they can get. You know, and in the spirit of Delilah, they present themselves as being very attractive. Samson loved Delilah. If you want to go back and see the stories of Samson and what we're talking about, you find it right there in the book of Judges, chapter 16. And Samson loved her. And his desire was to love her, but she never loved Samson. And even though she claimed that the love of Samson was important to her, and the only thing that she could, the only way she could define Samson's love or her love for Samson was in knowing these little secrets and knowing these details about his life. But all the while, she never loved him. And it seems like in a lot of Samson's story, he's winging it. He's just trying to do the best he can with the power of his own works. He's trying to do everything without God's help. He lacks a lot of discernment. And when you have the spirit or heart for revenge and you're full of malicious thoughts and anger towards those who have hurt or violated you, and you only want to see their destruction, sometimes in your desire to destroy them, you end up destroying yourself. And that's something we want to be careful of. We don't want to be like those who hurt and violated us. We don't want to allow what they did to define who we are. And that's a part of that reclaiming our innocence. You're not guilty of a crime because you were molested. Or you were abused as a child. You're not guilty of a crime, but sometimes there are people who come into your life and they'll use that truth, that embarrassing moment in your life as a weapon against you as they seek to manipulate you and ultimately trying to sever you from God. This is how so many people wind up swamped in, were immersed in drug addictions and alcoholism. This is how the drug addict hooks you or tries to pull you away from God and giving to you a false God. Now, I got the answers to your problems. It's right here in my viper venom. In my poison. And there's a lot of people, you know, who are very narcissistic, very selfish, and it's all about their own personal gain. And they find their strength in controlling over you, having control over you. And they gain control over you by trying to convince you that what you did, what you were exposed to, let me say it that way, is not only the thing that defines you, I'm going to use that embarrassing act to break you down so that I can have control over you. You know, narcissists are very likable people when they're out in public. Very likable person when they're at work. But behind closed doors, when they're at home, they're all alone with the people they say they love. It's quite the different story. And when we're living under the effects of being abused by a child, sometimes we gravitate towards unhealthy, toxic relations. And it's because our sense of discernment has been broken down. Our ability to set strong, healthy boundaries has been broken down. Just because you forgive your abuser doesn't give them the excuse to continue the abuse. It doesn't make it okay that they abused you or that they can continue to abuse you. It's allowing that to let it go. Let it go, let them go. You don't have to be in their life or a part of their life. It's for your well-being. It's for you. It's for you. Again, read the whole story of Samson and Delilah. We covered a little bit of that last video in chapter 16, Book of Judges. Today I want to talk about this. Let us move right here to back over into the book of Galatians. And again, our topic is sacrificial love and innocence, and grabbing hold of the power behind implementing that in our lives. And believing that the essence of God, what makes God good, why do we want God in our life, is because He is the definition of sacrificial love. And in his desire to display to us His sacrificial love, His love without the expectation of anything in return, in that he is innocent and sees you as being innocent. It's not about God's looking about how you did it wrong or what you did wrong and all these things. He's saying, my love is available to you. My love is for you. All you got to do is want it and be a part of it. God cleanses us by the power of the Holy Spirit from all unrighteousness. Of all those feelings of being ashamed or embarrassed. Now he says this, Paul, chapter 5, verse 13 from the book of Galatians. This is what makes the teachings and instructions of God viable, important, useful. Why we as parents and children, you want to break the chain? You want to break the chain? And teach these things to your children. You want to ensure that your children grow up and aren't abused or sexually molested throughout their lives, and them growing up to become healthy, sound thinking, sober adults. Teach these things to your children. Chapter 5, verse 13 from the book of Galatians says this, Paul speaking. For you were called to freedom, brothers. Do not use your freedom as an opportunity for the flesh, but through love serve one another. For the whole law is fulfilled in one word, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. But if you bite and devour one another, watch out that you are not consumed by one another. And maybe Paul learned this thing, and he's speaking of it in his own words, but that of Samson, and how Samson, in the devouring, you know, I'm going to repay evil for evil and all this stuff, and he begins to devour his neighbors, and his neighbors seek to devour him. And in that, they all perish, and they all perish together. Samson's eyes are gouged out. They gouge out his eyes. And they make him the joke or the clown of the entire community. There's nothing worse than having your secrets and your embarrassing moments in life brought out into a place of public, and then inside of a public setting, you become the absolute joke of it all. There's nothing worse than that in life. And that's how manipulators manipulate people. You know, it's how abusers gain an upper hand over their victims. It says, But I say, walk by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the flesh. For the desires of the flesh are against the Spirit, and the desires of the Spirit are against the flesh. For they are opposed to each other to keep you from doing the things you want to do. But if you are led by the Spirit, you are not under the law. Now, the works of the flesh are evident: sexual immorality, impurity, sensuality, idolatry, sorcery, enmity, strife, jealousy, fits of anger, rivalries, dissensions, divisions, envy, drunkenness, orgies, and things like. And I warn you, as I warned you before, that those who do such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, peace, joy, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such things there is no law. And those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. If we live by the Spirit, let us also keep in step with the Spirit. Let us not become conceited, provoking one another, and envying one another. So he clearly says, you know, these people, those people who have violated you, who abused you, and who practice these things and have no desire to repent or turn away or to acknowledge they're wrong in doing these things, will never inherit the kingdom of God. They'll never be able to inherit the Holy Spirit, to be able to receive the Holy Spirit. They're never going to be able to display love or joy or peace or patience or kindness or goodness or faithfulness or gentleness. Everything Samson was in the story of Samson is 100% the opposite of the fruits of the Spirit. I mean, just because you believe God, well, even the demons and the devils believe God. Devil believes God, but what separates them from us is our desire to become like God. So if we're going to walk by the Spirit, let us be in step with the Spirit. And the essence of God is sacrificial love. A desire to display love to us without an expectation of return. So you can forgive somebody and not have they don't have to accept your forgiveness for it to be viable, for it to be true. What makes your forgiveness viable and true is your ability to let go of the fits of rage and anger, to let go of the desires for malice. Malice is the destruction of your enemies. Sometimes when the effects of being sexually abused as a child, or even abused as a child in some other way, it's not always physical abuse. Sometimes it's emotional abuse. Sometimes it's mental abuse. No greater form of abuse than to neglect your children, to just pretend like they don't even exist, to not even care when they're hungry, hurting, or in trouble. To convince your child they would be better off dead than to be a nuisance into my life. And some of the effects of being abused as a child is like if you were sexually abused, you try to convince yourself somehow, somewhere along the line in life that sex will love you. The acts of sex are going to love you. The act of sensuality is going to love you. But sex will never love you. It's not even, it's nothing to do with love. Love is far from the acts of sex. But when your mind is broken, when you've been broken as a child, you have a twisted, distorted view of the world. You know, probably for many men who were molested as young boys, they live their life thinking, oh, a woman is a nice pair of boobs. A woman has the perfect figure eight glass, hourglass shape, you know. A woman is there with a nice butt. A woman has blue eyes. A woman has beautiful hair. Never recognizing that a woman is a mother. A woman is a daughter. Instead of seeing a friend and the beauty of the woman coming out from the content of her character, flowing out from the truth that lives within her heart, it's looking at all the things that are surrounded in the sensuality. You have impure thoughts. Sometimes when people are abused as children, they grow up and they're addicted or swamped into pornographic material. We wanna let go of all of that. Grab hold of our innocence. And our innocence is found in our desire to be one of God's children. And if we have the desire to be one of God's children, then we dedicate our lives. We try and practice. We dedicate our heart and the content of the things that matter to us, that flow from us, we dedicate them to love, to joy and peace and patience. We make these things a priority in our life. We try to implement those things into our life because that's what makes life good. And God desires for you to have abundance of life, a good life. These are the spirits, the fruit of God's spirit. He is love. He is full of joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness. God is full of self-control. I mean, the world is waiting for it to destroy itself. A lot of people are out there and so angry and upset, they believe that God is sitting back in heaven, and at any moment that the wrath of God is going to flow out onto the earth and burn it up into a ball of fire and consume all the elements of the universe. And maybe, as according to the Bible, one day that might happen. But God displays his kindness, his gentleness, his love, his patience by his self-control, by waiting for you to believe. God is not slow in anger or slow in giving us justice. Instead, he's waiting for you to believe. To believe in his sacrificial love, to believe in his integrity, to believe he is faithful, to believe he loves you. Now, We have this as well. 2 Timothy chapter 3 says this. Again, that these are the things that give us discernment. And if we taught our children these things, Samson's life was dedicated to the will of God. And Samson maybe he was a teacher. And how he taught what was learn from my mistakes. Be what I am not. That's why it's recorded. That's why it's all written down. That's why it's there. Even Paul says, you know, all scripture is God-breathed. And it's good for us. It's good for rebuking and correcting and in the training of righteousness so that we are prepared to do the work of God. Now, Timothy chapter 3 says this, but understand this, that in the last days there will come times of difficulty. For people will be lovers of self, lovers of money, proud, arrogant, abusive, disobedient to their parents, ungrateful, unholy, heartless, unappeasable, slanderous, without self-control, brutal, not loving good, treacherous, reckless, swollen with conceit, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God, having the appearance of godliness but denying its power. We see all of that fully alive in the story of Samson and Delilah. We see it fully being acted out and lived out all through the story of Samson, which is found there in the book of Judges of chapters 13 through 18. And all of this, and so what do we want to do? We want to prepare our children because they, like lambs, like sheep, are going to be sent out into a world that's full of ravishing, vicious, ferocious wolves. And how are they going to be prepared to interact with these wolves if we don't prepare them with the Word of God? And being baptized in the Holy Spirit and having God in you and with you, walking by the Spirit, in step with the Spirit, is your greatest protection. Being able to display acts of sacrificial love and having a command over that ability. That is a God-given gift to you for your protection, for your well-being. And join us Sunday morning, 9:30. And we have recording here. It comes out Sunday afternoon, but if you were here in Ray, Colorado, come on in and be a part of Sunday service as we'll go over some of the things of what Jesus says about sacrificial love and how we can't gain the kingdom of heaven. We can't enter into the kingdom of heaven unless we make sacrificial love a priority in our lives. Avoid such people, he says, having appearance of godliness, but denying its power. Avoid such people. For among them are those who creep into households and capture weak women, burdening them with sins and led astray by various passions, always learning and never able to arrive at a knowledge of truth. And, you know, the devil's always going to present himself to us as an angel of light, masquerading around as an angel of light. He comes to us in the form of righteousness, but is always denying the power of God. And that's something why I believe in these teachings and instructions. And if we apply them and implement them to our lives, and not just our lives, but to our children's lives, raising them up through these teachings, through the Word of God, you can be healed. You can overcome situations or storms that were placed into our lives without being destroyed. You'll be fine. You're going to make it. You're going to be okay. But if we don't have these things, this is why there's so many homeless people right now all across the United States of America, and they're young. Most of the people who are homeless in the United States of America are 35 years and younger. Not just like a bunch of old crippled folks. These are vibrant people at the peak of their life, at the vigor of their life, where life should be lived in its fullness, full of joy and peace and love. And yet, they struggle to survive each day. This is a real problem. It's a real issue. And the only way to break the chain or to turn this problem around is by grabbing hold of the living God and some of his teachings and believing in the power of God to heal, the desire for God to heal us and to transform us. But in all of it, we must be honest. I got to be honest. I got to confess my errors. I got to confess my struggles, my issues. I got to confess I'm struggling with this problem in order for God to fix it, to work on it. For among them are those who creep into households and capture weak women. It sounds to me vulnerable women. Among them are those who molest, violate, rape women and burden them down with sin. Burden them down with this idea that you have something to be embarrassed about, that you're wrong, you're bad, it's all your fault. And then you're burdened down with the inability to believe in God's power. Because they can't believe in the power of God and the love of God, they seek out a different God, a different power, a different healer. And they try to self-medicate themselves through Satan's viper venom, his poison. Just as Jannes and Jambres opposed Moses, and if you don't know who they are, maybe we got to go back to Moses' story and some of the stuff spoken of back in the book of Numbers, Deuteronomy, book of Exodus, Leviticus, books of Genesis. Find out what they did. So these men also oppose the truth, men corrupted in mind and disqualified regarding the faith. But they will not get very far, for their folly will be plain to all, as was that of those two men. You, however, have followed my teachings, my conduct, my aim in life, my faith, my patience, my love, my steadfastness, my persecutions and sufferings that happened to me at Antioch, at Iconium, and at Lystra, which persecutions I endured. Yet from them all, the Lord rescued me. So no matter how big the storm was, no matter how much he was persecuted, how hard of a beating he took, thrown into prison, or whatever it was that Paul was subjected to, the Lord rescued him. And that goes for us today. You're here. You're here. Your abuser might not be here, but you are here. So God certainly hasn't forgotten you. He hasn't forgotten you. And when Jesus told me to go out into the world and tell the world that he's coming, he didn't forget you. He didn't forget you. He hasn't forsaken you. He loves you. You're here. You were not utterly destroyed. You're here. And you still have some strength in you. You still have some integrity in you. You still have some faith in you. And I believe you have the ability to display a sense of sacrificial love. That's within you. He goes on to say, indeed, all who desire to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will be persecuted, while evil people and imposters will go on from bad to worse, deceiving and being deceived. You know, again, I say this because, you know, there's a lot of Mormons running around in the internet. And they always want you to come and read the Book of Mormons, which I believe is inspired by the devil. Inspired by the devil. And why do I believe Mormonism and the Mormon religion has been inspired by the devil? Because they are masters of manipulation. They are the kind of people who are like being controlled over by the spirit of Delilah, who look you over and try to find a truth about you, an embarrassing moment about you, and then try to use that truth against you as a weapon of war, a weapon to destroy you. If you don't believe me, look at the acts of what those two women were doing when they were abusing their children. It's the stories all over the internet. I don't want to speak their names or who they are, but you've probably heard of them. It's a big story right now, and how a woman was abusing her children and always looking over a truth about them and their children, and it's for this reason. Now, you don't get a bedroom. You don't get a bed to sleep in. You don't get no food. They are abusive, destructive people. And this has been going on for 100 years, a couple hundred years, or however long it's been about. They engage in acts of sexual immorality. In fact, they put a reward for those who engage in sexual immorality by saying those who have multiple wives are able to gain or have access into the highest celestial kingdom of God. You want to be in the presence of God? Well, you need 3 or 4 or 5 or 10 wives. But all of it, they're imposters. Running around pretending to be holy and righteous people while they abuse and destroy and violate young children. You're very rarely ever going to see a sound-thinking, sober-minded person go into Mormonism. No, they have 10 kids. They have lots of children, and their children are raised into it, and that's how they grow their numbers. That's how it is with Islam as well. A sound-thinking, sober-minded person is not going to join the Islamic religion. No, they have 10 to 15 children, and that's how they grow their religion. But as for you, continue in what you have learned and have firmly believed, knowing from whom you learned it, and how from childhood you have been acquainted with the sacred writings, which are able to make you wise for salvation through faith in Christ Jesus. All scripture is breathed out by God and profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and for the training in righteousness, that the man of God may be complete, equipped for every good work. You need this. And when he's saying the sacred writings, he's talking about the Hebrew Bible, the Old Testament, the stories of King David, the stories of Saul, 1 and 2 Samuel, the stories of 1 and 2 Kings that we find in there, the stories found in the books of Judges, stories found in the book of Joshua, in the book of Job, and the five books of Moses, which are known as the Torah. They are a guide unto Jesus Christ, a guide into having faith in Christ, which is our foundation. Everything rides on faith in Christ. We must have faith in Christ's faithfulness. We must have faith in Christ's integrity. We must have faith in Christ's ability to display an innocent form of sacrificial love. God and his love is a gift, and it doesn't cost us anything, and he expects nothing in return. He gives it to us freely so that we can be free. And what do we find in God's gifts and his promises? The Holy Spirit, being baptized in the power of the Holy Spirit, which empowers us with love, grace, forgiveness, powers us with patience, self-control, the ability to display acts of sacrificial love, the ability to forgive, the ability to be godly. And that's what this world needs right now. Men and women who have a desire to be holy.